They use code words. The drivers, the crew chief, the spotters, and apparently they used code words, didn't understand it, and never came to Peru.
Apparently you have a different sheet than I have, but yeah, that's what happens when you, we should not have done that. My sticker in here says hot dog and stay out.
Here they come now, working back off turn number four. We've got 47 laps to go. You've got Kevin Harvick and Kyle Busch. They'll work together on the inside. Meanwhile, on the outside, Eric Almirola, Denny Hamlin, Matt DiBenedetto, they'll work together, shoving each other all the way up the banking at turn number one.
And Alex Almirola's moment off of turn number four. The car was slow, looked like he had a tire down, and now the tire casing has come out of the car.
Joey Logano, Austin Dillon on the inside.
Harvick gets away momentarily with the lead, not getting a lot of shove from behind, though. Denny Hamlin still there on the inside lane. Let's see what Denny can do. They're side by side with Truex. Look at this. What's the difference? It's Harvick by a nose off to.
Here comes Denny Hamlin.
Do not go anywhere. This is far from being over. Here comes Denny. Five to go. Separation now. Just two car lengths. Kevin Harvick in the Ford, Hamlin in the Toyota, they're back in one.
Does Hamlin have anything left? Drives deep into the corner, goes to the outside, and he's got easy enough on race here, Kevin Harvick.
Denny Hamlin's got a full head of steam, here he comes, on the back bumper of Harvick. Hamlin looks to the inside, Harvick blocks, checkered flag in the air, and Kevin Harvick wins the Consumers Energy 400 in Michigan.
There you go, good job.
Great job, guys, awesome job, 2 days in a row.
That's how it sounded yesterday on the Motor Racing Network. What a weekend for Kevin Harvick, Rodney Childers, and that number four Busch Light Apple Ford team. They ran 322 laps, and Kevin Harvick led 182 of them and got both wins.
Really proud of everybody, Busch Light Apple Ford Mustang team. They've done a great job, and everybody has a great team. Covered all the details and getting our cars close. Michigan, as we talked yesterday, has always been a really good racetrack for us as we've gone through the year. And this weekend was no different. They nailed it yesterday. Track changed a little bit today where our car was a little bit too tight in 3 and 4. Almost gave up at the end, but had just enough to get back to victory lane. And just really proud of everybody on our team.
Yeah, were you nervous? There was one point, at least they were showing on the television broadcast, that it looked like you had to get out of it coming out of two, but it seemed like Denny did as well, so that kind of worked out in your favor.
Yeah. Just, when he had to lift a couple times, it gave me a little bit of breathing room to get through one and two, and then make it all back up in 3 and 4. He had options, to run wherever he wanted to. That's where I was yesterday. I had options. And, I could do that in 1 and 2, but I didn't have that option in 3 and 4 for whatever reason. It was just flying the front tires, and I couldn't get car points like I wanted to. But, it's just it's a race to the finish line and checkered flag, and they were able to get there first and hold him off, and had just enough to go back-to-back in Michigan.
Denny Hamlin came close to picking up the win in race 2 at MIS. He is relegated back to the number 2 finishing position.
We knew we had a really fast car. We just kind of took the whole race to show it to everyone. They took us all along to get to the front of what we really kind of wanted to, but we did a little bit of a little bit better today than what it was yesterday, and enjoyed that little battle at the end, and just wish I would have had a little bit more time to work them over, but ultimately happy with the result.
Martin Truex Jr. should be happy with his. Although they had some challenges, they were able to get top three in both races, finishing third in race 2.
Another tough day for us, obviously. Thought we had a really strong car all day yesterday, and went to work on the auto inventory the last night, trying to make it better, and boy, did we mess it up. So, we talked yesterday about just that, not messing it up, and it's easy to do. So we missed it at the start. We were way off, super loose, and tail way back, and had to battle all day. So proud of the effort, obviously, to come back to third, and just didn't quite have enough at the end there. So we battled hard for that one, and obviously proud of scrap metal, so a good finish.
Kyle Busch finished in fourth and explains what the difference was between the two races.
Nothing really. I felt like it was really similar. And again today, our M&M's Slush Brownie Camry was good. top three car. I felt like the four, the two, us, the 11 there at the end was really good. Us and the 19 were the same, so just hard to pass when you get there towards the end and try to make moves on guys, and they just block your air and do what they're supposed to do to prevent you from getting by them. It's just tough racing like that, and just built tight there at the end and just couldn't get any more, but that's not all we were going to get anyway today. So, that's on par, I guess, here in Michigan.
And finishing in fifth, Joey Logano.
I think ultimately what helped us today is that we started closer to where we didn't lose all our track position. We didn't get damaged really early in the race like we did yesterday. They went a different route with their car build and kind of learned some things. So that's the nice part about two races in a row. You can learn something one of these weekends, which is it's been hard to do without practice. So, top five for the Shell Pezzo Mustang is not what we want, but it's in the ballpark at least. And we keep fine-tuning it from here.
And here's how they finished race two. Kevin Harvick, Hamlin, Truex, Busch, Logano, the top five. Eric Almirola finished in sixth. It was Matt DiBenedetto in seventh. Austin Dillon in eighth. Chase Elliott ninth. And Kurt Busch finished in tenth.
11th went to Jimmy Johnson. William Byron was 12th. Ryan Newman 13th. 14th to Clint Bowyer. Matt Kenseth finished 15th. Ryan Preece was 16th. Christopher Bell 17th. 18th to Ty Dillon. 19th, Ricky Stenhouse Jr. And finishing 20th was Chris Buescher.
Bubba Wallace finished in 21st. It was Corey LaJoie in 22nd. John Hunter Nemechek in 23rd. 24th was Tyler Reddick. And 25th was Cole Custer. Daniel Suarez finished in 26th. Eric Jones, 27th. Michael McDowell, 28th. J.J. Haley, 29th. And Brennan Poole in 30th.
31st, Reed Sorensen. Quinn Hauff was 32nd. Josh Balicki, 33rd. Garrett Smithley, 34th. 35th, Timmy Hill. Alex Bowman, 36th. James Davison, 37th. 38th, Ryan Blaney, and 39th, Brad Keselowski.
Took them 2 hours, 9 minutes, and 35 seconds to run that second cup race. Average speed, 144.463 miles an hour. There were only five cautions for 24 laps, 10 lead changes among six drivers. Next up for the NASCAR Cup Series, it's a trip to Daytona International Speedway.
upcoming violation, 14-hour workday limit, 11-hour driving limit.
Here racing across the board, two different racetracks. You and I were Road America, so I'll start there just again. But for 11 years in a row now, a different winner in Victory Lane and Austin Cindric, the latest, and what I thought was a pretty fun race when we got down to the end of things. You go to Michigan, you know, Mike, I don't care how good you are, to be able to win back-to-back races in the NASCAR Cup Series in this age and era like Kevin Harvick did, that was an incredible, I thought, achievement for that race team. And, you know, those races, I thought, we'll get into this when we get to checker flags and black flags. I thought the distance of those races were really good. I thought the intensity level was good. I thought we had good racing Saturday. Maybe not quite as good Sunday, but still pretty interesting. And then on Friday night, craziness at the end with that Truck Series race for sure. But always good to see a first-time winner in Zane Smith. So I thought you had a little bit of everything across the board in the NASCAR world this weekend. And if you like that, stick around. We got a lot more for you coming up this weekend at Daytona.
Speaking of checker flags, black flags, they are coming up next with NASCAR Senior VP of Competition Scott Miller joining us at the top of the hour. Time now for a 15-second race recap presented by Geico. Geico now offering an extra 15% credit on car, motorcycle, and RV policies. Visit geico.com for more. Kevin Harvick winning race number one and race number two at Michigan International Speedway. You had Austin Cindric picking up his fourth win of 2020 by winning the Henry 180 at Road America in Elkhart Lake, Wisconsin. And Zane Smith getting his first career win in the NASCAR Gander RV and Outdoors Truck Series in the Irish Hills of Michigan as well. This is MRN's Mike Bagwell, and your NASCAR Cup Series race day just got that much better. NASCAR Finish Line app is not just a chance to win $25,000. The free-to-play app provides you a brand-new fan experience based on your weekly picks. With expert analysis and live in-race tracking of your picks, you'll be fully engaged week-to-week with the NASCAR Cup Series. Go to your Apple Store or Google Play and download the next greatest...
fucking done, man, that last one.
Yeah, whoop de doo, the one that fucking was like the last one going up. Yeah, that one was.
The ones you couldn't really see.
I slowed the hell down and I still hit it a pretty good clip. Negative, Cannon Chef. We are in Virginia now. Only 120 miles from the shop. I've only been off for 22 minutes. Twenty.
Hot Live. We're off to Daytona this weekend. Not for the type of racing that we're used to at the World Center of Racing. We're going road course racing this weekend. A lot of nuances to road racing at Daytona. We see it all the time with the Rolex 24. But, Scott, I'll start first with the chicane that was added coming out of Speedway Turn 4 and coming into the Trioval. Why was that decision made to put that chicane in? And who made the call? And how was the call made to design it and obviously get the Turtles from Charlotte to help with that process?
What necessitated it was just we were very concerned about the speeds getting into Turn 1 and Delta V, which is how much the cars have to slow down miles per hour wise. So we weren't sure that that the top speeds were going to be extremely high, which was a concern. And a big concern was just whether or not the brakes were going to be able to sustain that over the course of the race distance. So we had to kind of slow down the entry to Turn 1, and chicane was a really good way to do it. You know, we had a lot of help from the teams and the OEMs in the driver simulators, trying to predict lap times and lap speeds, and working together with them, and fantastic collaboration with SMI. We used some of the, as you mentioned, some of the components of the chicane that they put in, and really designed the chicane based on what they had done on the front straightaway there at Charlotte Motor Speedway. But it had to go in to accommodate the speeds and the brakes that are on our car. You know, the cars that typically run there are different animal, wider, bigger brakes, and so we had to adjust a little bit, and I think it will be very interesting.
So there are four races there. The Cup race will be Sunday. Why was the mandate put in, Scott, that drivers could only race in one series? And simply just to try to not give anyone a competitive advantage at a racetrack that no one's raced on basically before?
Yeah, we really just didn't want some of the guys that could, the Cup guys, or even the Xfinity guys in truck, even all the way down to America. Like, it wouldn't have been fair for drivers to get dragged off on the track, prior to their like gathering event. So that's not unprecedented, because that's the rule for the first time. It doesn't allow any tech drivers in the Xfinity race. So, it's something that we've done before, and it's entirely to keep track time equitable for everybody.
When you
there's a hell of a pickup right there.
Everybody else congregate in the tower, and you're looking down on Daytona this weekend. What will you be looking for to gauge the success of this race?
Right. In 2.5 miles, turn right on Max Nanos Road. Turn left on Ready Mix Road, then take the first left.
That's kind of our normal benchmark, which is we need to go out there and be able to put on a compelling show.
Well, we got the rest of the month of August here to finish things up, and last week we found out where the rest of the season's going to be. For now, I would imagine it's got to be somewhat of a relief for all of you there.
Turn left on I-77 South.
Yeah, for sure. It's been a long road to get there. I'm glad we were able to get it across the line, and it was, you think about vendors like Goodyear, they have been super cooperative through this whole thing with, venue changes and all that. I mean, they have a production.
What's that? Be careful when you go to make that turn, because people don't understand what a stop sign means over on that other side. Truck's basically pulled in front of me, and I had to right away. I had no stop sign, and I had a four-wheeler do the same thing.
I-71, on the right, to I-77 south.
And they will be opening more to sell. And if you're not going for one of the biggest and beautiful
that's all we had to do back there, right? It was just fuel. Like, we didn't have to, you know, get any grills or anything and push them onto the trailer or fuel cans or anything. Brother, man.